Another use case of dynamic binding is testing. I want us to recall, this is an excerpt from homework 5. In homework 5, the solution, essentially what we have is as follows. We're going to have an eval function that evaluates expression, and then we have a function that evaluates terms. And in each of them, the function that evaluates terms has to call the one that has to evaluate expressions. And inside the implementation of how we implement expressions, we also have to call evaluate terms. And the problem with this kind of mutually recursive code is that it's very hard to test. And indeed, that is something you might have noticed, is if you upload your homework, even though you might have one part correct, because I cannot test them independently, it's not as easy to get better grades as it is in homework 4, where both codes are separated. Let's revise what we did in homework 4. We did in homework 4 was that we had a parameter called subst, right, which was the substitution function. And inside, you would then call subst whenever you want to do substitution, rather than calling r colon subst. This is how we kind of broke the dependency between r eval and r subst. And in homework 5, we didn't have a way to do that, right? Because if we just added another parameter, it would become even more complicated. So kind of the trade-off that we have here is we are basically making calling reval more complicated. Now you had to learn about this extra parameter and what it was, what it meant, how to use it, versus something that is simpler to use, which is homework 5. There is no extra parameter. What you see is what you get, but it is way harder to test. So wouldn't it be nice to have the best of both worlds? To both have an interface such as in homework 5, but with the added benefit of being able to test substitution and R evaluation separately. That would be great. So in fact, you can do that with the notion of dynamic binding. So what we do is, the idea is to create a parameter in your interpreter, which is, what is the substitution function? And what is the evaluation? But in this case, let's just make the parameter is subs, so let's make that into an actual dynamic binding parameter. So what we do is we call make parameter, and we initialize it with our subs. That is our own definition of substitute. And then we no longer need to provide the parameter of substitution in our eval. What that does is then, inside our eval, if I want to call subst, I don't call it directly. What I do instead is I look up what is the current value of substitution in the parameter subst impl. Okay? That's how I should call it if I were to use parameters. And then you would have the best of both worlds. Our eval does not have that explicit parameter there of subst, but it's still, you still can replace the substitution function upon calling our eval. So similarly, if I wanted to change homework 5 to make it so that we can test sevalexp and sevalterm independently from one another, we would have to create two parameters, one for evalexp and another one for evalterm, and then we would be able to independently test each one. Unfortunately, that is not what's happening in homework 5, so please be mindful of it. The reason I didn't do it was because understanding what parameters are is actually a bit complicated. You know, why is there a call here? Why don't I just call sevalterm? And people would forget about it, and the net effect would be the same. So perhaps next year I might consider doing. So then if I wanted to call something, you can always parameterize. So say here, I wanted to just replace, let's say I didn't implement even eval, I had implemented the evaluation of terms, but let's say I didn't implement seval expressions yet. So what you could do is you could run your partial implementation, and you could provide a dummy function that just returns the number 10, and that would replace the behavior of seval by something that you know exactly what it is. That is actually used quite often in object-oriented programming, where you have a class that you don't really know what the implementation is, and you provide a fake implementation, usually if you have like an interface or something. That is known as mocking. That's something that perhaps you should be Googling and learning a bit about. Mock testing is something very cool. And that's basically it. That's the last thing I wanted to show you, how to use parameters to make your code more testable. The insight is really functions are really global. And if you have any kind of dependencies among functions and you want to break it down, a very effective way of doing that is by using parameters, by using this parameterize. That is a great way of making your functional code a bit more testable, which you should consider if you're doing something more, you know, more industrial. So that is it. That's the last kind of video I wanted to talk to you about. Hope you had fun.